मैथमेटिकल रीजनिंग, ओके, मैथमेटिकल रीजनिंग. लेट मी टेल यू, दिस इज वन ऑफ द वेरी इजीएस्ट ऑफ ऑल टॉपिक्स दैट यू आर गोइंग टू गेट. नॉर्मली इन कॉम्पिटिटिव एग्जाम्स, स्पेशली इफ यू टॉक अबाउट जेईई मेन, वन क्वेश्चन एवरी ईयर कम्स ऑन दिस, ओके, एंड दैट इज वेरी वेरी इजी. सो आई डोंट यू नो find anybody making mistakes in such topics. Okay, so I'm planning to cover up this topic in today's session itself, so it is not that big also. So I think one class is more than enough to finish off this topic. So let's get started. I think people have started joining in. So mathematical reasoning is basically a vertical of maths which actually comes from logic. Okay, so logic was one of the ancient fields of mathematics, even before geometry. So there used to be some group of people called Sufists. Okay, they were actually, you know, disciples of Aristotle, Thales, and all those people who used to roam around in villages, you know, trying to, you know, pass on certain statements, logical statements, which used to confuse people. Okay, which used to baffle people. And that's how they used to, you know, earn their source of, you know, whatever income they had. Okay, but later on, this field of mathematics was standardized, and nowadays it is used in the field of electronics and computer science. I'm sure most of you would have done logic gates in computer science. In fact, when you study electrical and electronics engineering later on, let's say some of you would like to opt for it, you would be coming across logic gates. Okay, so all those fields of engineering and computer science, they are basically based on this concept of logic. So mathematical reasoning is one of the, you can say, application is to prove certain statements by the act of deduction. Okay, so there are two ways normally we prove statements in mathematics. One is by induction, which I'm sure you would have done in school, principle of mathematical induction, that works on induction principle. So induction principle is you basically work on specifics to prove a generic thing. In mathematical reasoning, you go the other way around. You use the generic thing to prove a specific thing. Okay, that is called the art of proving a mathematical statement by deduction. Okay, so there's one induction, there's another deduction. However, this is just a history part of it, and the in general know-how of what is mathematical reasoning. So primarily in this topic, we are going to talk about statements. Okay, we are going to talk about statements, and towards the last part of the topic, we are going to even validate statements. So first of all, I would like to know from you, what is the difference between sentences and statements? So what is the difference between a sentence and a statement? Can anybody reply that? Yes, Boolean algebra is definitely a part of it. You'll realize it later on. Boolean, maybe you can say it's an advanced version of it. But yes, it has obviously been inspired from the concept of logic. Yes, what's a sentence? So sentence is nothing but it's a meaningful collection of words, isn't it? It's a meaningful collection of words. Okay. So a collection of words which has got certain meaning attached to it, that is called sentence. Okay. Normally, sentence could be of various types. Okay, Achintya has given an idea. Statement is a fact. Okay, we'll discuss that out. So there are following types of sentences that we normally use in our day-to-day communication. Okay. So types of sentences, there's something called assertions. Or assertive sentences. Okay, assertive sentences. Assertive sentences are nothing but assertions or propositions where you're trying to assert something or where you're trying to propose something. Okay, for example, if I say 3 is an odd number, this is something which I'm asserting, isn't it? Or I'm proposing that 3 is a prime number. Okay, for example, I can say, let's say Earth is a star. Earth is a star. Now, I may be wrong in my proposition also. For example, if you see, Earth is a star is a wrong proposition or it's a false proposition. But nevertheless, it's a proposition. Okay. So Any assertive statement is like a proposition where you are proposing or asserting something, and that could be true, false, or it could be open-ended also. For example, if I say X is greater than 7. Okay, so I'm proposing X is greater than 7. Now, here we don't know whether it is true or false. Depending upon X value, we can take a call, right? So in these three examples which I have taken, you are trying to assert or you're trying to propose something. So this is called an assertive sentence. Okay. Another type of sentence that we normally use is imperative sentence. Okay, what's an imperative sentence or imperative sentences? Imperative sentences are those sentences where you make a request or a command. Okay, where you make a request or you command something. Right. So normally when we talk, there are certain cases, there are certain instances when we request something. Correct. Right. For example, please give me a glass of water. Right. You're making a request. Okay. Glass of water. Daivittu swalpa neer kudi. That's what we say, no? Karana, am I correct? Daivittu swalpa neeru kudi. Correct. Okay. Or you're giving some command to somebody. Switch on the lights. Okay. Switch on the lights. Okay. So this is a command that you are making, right? Another type of sentences that we use is interrogative sentence, where you try to interrogate somebody or you're trying to question somebody. Okay. So this is a sentence where some kind of a question is involved. For example, how much did you score in your UTs? How much did you score in your last UT? In your last UT. Sir, your examples are also like, UT. Obviously, UT is a very important event for most of you. By the way, this is a mock which I'm making because many of you miss classes because of UTs. Okay. Something could be like, where were you last Sunday? Where were you last Sunday? Okay. So these are sentences where you're asking a question. Okay. Of course, it has a question mark. And another type of sentence is your exclamatory sentence. By the way, I'm not trying to teach you English over here because I'm no English teacher here, but these type of concepts are actually asked in the competitive exam. Okay. They will ask you to write down the type of sentence being used in a certain state, in a certain particular question. Okay. Exclamatory sentences are those sentences where you are trying to express some kind of a wish. Okay. You're wishing somebody, or maybe you are expressing some kind of a joy or sorrow, or any kind of an excitement. Okay. For example, what a wonderful day. Now here you're not asking any question. You're not asking what a wonderful day. You're just saying you're very happy that it's a wonderful day. Okay. Or alas, we lost our CDS. Okay. I hope some of you who are reading the news, I think day before yesterday, we lost the chief of defense staff, Mr. Bipin Rawat, very sad instance, okay, in a helicopter crash. So this is a sorrow which I am expressing. Okay. So these are the type of sentences that we normally use in our day-to-day communication. So what is a statement then? So this is sentence. Okay. Four types of sentence are there normally. So what's a statement then? So somebody said statement is where you are stating a fact. That is not correct actually. So what is a statement? Let me write that down. Statement are those sentences. So statements are those sentences. Or let me write statement singular. Statement is a sentence. A sentence. Of course, it is a part of a sentence. So sentence is a bigger set. Statements are subsets of it. A sentence which can be answered with a true or a false, but not both, and must be unambiguous, and must be unambiguous. That means in any sentence, if you can answer that sentence by saying a true or a false, just one of them, not both. You can't say sometimes true, sometimes false, or it could be both, sir. No. So those are not statements. So statements are those sentences where you have only one answer for its truth value, whether true or false, but not both. And there should not be any ambiguity. Ambiguity means there should not be any uncertainty in the way that sentence has been written, which makes you difficult to answer it with a true or a false, right? So please understand here, a statement follows law of excluded middle. It can either be true or could be false. It cannot have both the status. And there must not be any ambiguity about it. Okay. Now, a few things I would like to add on over here. If there is a statement where you feel that there is a variable involved, okay, that means because of the variable, you are not able to say whether it is true or false, then those sentences, I would say not those statements, those sentences are actually called as open statement. Okay. Open statement is a word which is basically used for those sentences which could have become statement provided the unknown involved in that sentence is known to you. Right? For example, if I say there is life, or you can say he is a good person. Okay. He is a good person. Now, you don't know whether that person, who is this he? Are you talking about Mahatma Gandhi? Right? Or are you talking about Dawood Ibrahim? Who is this he? So till you know who is this he, you will not be able to say a true or a false. Correct? So in that case, it becomes a open statement. Many people say, sir, open statement means statement only. No. Open statement means something which is eligible to become a statement. It is open to become a statement. Open means ready. And it could become a statement if you make that small change in that sentence by removing that variable name. Okay. Sentences which are both true and false are actually called paradoxes. Yes, Aryan, absolutely. Okay. this statement is false. Why it is a paradox? It's a statement. So what is a paradox? Paradox is where you have both the chances of it being true or false. So those are not statements. Those are called paradox. Okay. Anyways, we are not going to talk about paradox, etc. But very important thing to understand is what is an open statement? Open statement are those sentences where there is a variable involved or there is an uncertainty involved. Because of that uncertainty, we cannot say that statement is true or a false, right? Another example is, let's say if I say there is life beyond Earth, let's say I make this statement. Okay. Now, are you in a position to say true to this? Has it been found that there is life beyond Earth? But if we have not found it, does it make us eligible to say that there is no life at all since you have not found it? Okay. So we cannot say a true or a falsehood because there is uncertainty about it right now. So this is an open statement, right? The moment we realize that there is a planet or there is a, you know, celestial body where life is existing, then that would become a statement. Okay. Now, anyways, let's go back and analyze which of these four sentences are eligible to be called a statement. Eligible to be called a statement. Let us understand from the last one. Is your exclamatory sentence eligible to become a statement? Ask yourself. So you need to ask yourself, can I answer these questions with a true or a false, but not both? And are they unambiguous? So here, if you realize, what a wonderful day, you cannot say a true for it. Right? There is no true and a false answer to it. What a wonderful day is somebody's, you can say he's expressing his happiness, okay, of realizing that the day is a wonderful day. There's nothing true or false about it, right? So this is not a statement. This is not a state. This is not a statement. Okay. Now, what about interrogative sentence? Where were you last Sunday? Can you answer this with a true? Can you say a false? No, right? You will have to tell where were you, right? You have to give an answer in terms of a place, right? I was at my home, right? Or I was in the playground, right? So there is no true and false to this. So this sentence is also not a statement. Let me write it in white. Let it be consistently white. It's not a statement. Okay. There is some question coming up. Satyam, the below statement is false, the above statement is true. It's a pair of statements you're making. Okay, anyways, we'll come back to that. Now, imperative sentences. Imperative sentences is where you are making a command or a request. So this also you cannot answer with a true or a false. Please give me a glass of water. Will you say true for it? I don't think so. You'll say yes, I will give you, or you'll say no, I will not. Okay. So there's no true and false to this. So this is also not a statement. Not a statement. Okay. Now coming to the first one, assertive sentence. 3 is an odd number. You say, yes, true. Okay, so you can answer this with a true. Earth is a star. You'll say, no, false. Earth is a planet. Correct? 7, X is greater than 7. Now, this is ambiguous because there's a variable involved. So you cannot answer this with a true and a false. You know, one of them will be there. Depending upon X value, either it will be true or it will be false. Correct? But since you don't know X right now, you can't choose between true and a false. That means you cannot assign a truth value to this particular proposition. Correct? So this is an example of an open statement. Okay? You cannot say it's a statement. It's an open statement, by the way. Okay? So these two are eligible to be called as statements. So basically, please understand, those assertive sentences where there is no ambiguity, those are the only ones which we can call as statements. I'll repeat once again. The assertive sentences where there is no ambiguity, those will be only called as statements. It's called open statement. Okay. It's not an open-ended sentence. It's an open statement. Okay. But it is not a statement. The word open statement is basically used because it is open to become a statement. See, the word open has come from the fact that he's open to come. We say no in our normal talking. When we say, hey, will he come to the party? He's open to come. If you call him, he will come. Right? He's open. Open means he will agree if you ask him. But he may not even come. But he's open. Okay? So basically, this is not a statement, but it could become a statement if you provide some X value. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Okay. Statements are normally symbolized by a small alphabet. Normally, we use P, Q, R, S, T, etc. These alphabets that we use, they are called logical variables. They are called logical variables. Okay. Because they act like the variables in the field of logic. Okay, because we can have different types of statements being used, different statements being used in the same question. So in order to name those, we use variables. So they are called logical variables. To give an example, let's say 2 is a prime number. Okay, so this could be a statement. So this is an assertion, and you'll say you can always put a truth value to it. So in this case, it is a true, right? 2 is a prime number. We all know that, right? So this is the way we write a statement. Okay. If you would have done mathematical induction chapter, you would write P and a bracket N, right? Used to feed it a input N, correct? Because that N acted like the variable name involved in that particular statement. Now there's something called negation. Let me go to the next slide. Negation of a statement. Negation of a statement is exactly the opposite of what the statement says. Okay. For example, if I say 2 is a prime number. 2 is a prime number. Its negation will be represented by this symbol, P preceded by a tilde symbol. This symbol, you can find it on your keyboards also many a times. So this is called tilde symbol. So this will say opposite to what P says. That means it will say P, 2 is not a prime number. There are various ways in which you can write it. You can say it is not the case that 2 is a prime number. Okay, this is also a fine. Okay, or 2 is a composite number. Okay, so those are, there are many various ways in which you can express it. Okay, so negation has the opposite truth value as what P has. So if I make a truth value, so this is a typical truth table. Many of you would have used truth table in your junior classes. In fact, in computer science, you use truth tables. Okay, truth table is a table. Okay, let me just write it down for you all. What is a truth table? A table. Definition of a truth table. It's a table showing the truth value. By the way, truth value means true or false. Truth value means true and false. Many people say, so truth value means only true. No, just because the name has truth in it, it doesn't mean truth value means only true. So a table showing the truth value of a statement or a statement pattern or a WFF, well-formed formula. Okay. Now, normally we use WFF for a complicated statement. Okay. WFF. And it's component statements and its component statements. Component statements. That table is called a truth table. Okay. How many of you have seen truth table earlier on? I'm sure people who have taken computer science would be using. Yes, negation works like the not operator. Right, Aryan. Okay, many of you have seen. Okay, this year you have seen. Okay, so let's write down the truth table for negation of or not of a statement. So P, if it is true, its negation will be false. And if P is false, its negation will be true. Okay, so it basically acts like the not gate. Okay, so what is the truth table? It is clear. What is negation of a statement? That is also clear. Now, when it comes to negation, a very important type of question is asked to find negations of certain statements which start with a quantifier. Now, what is a quantifier? Let us learn that first, and then we'll talk about how do we find out negations of statements which start with quantifier or which has some quantifier inside it. So when it comes to quantifiers, there are two types of quantifiers that we normally talk about. One is called existential quantifier, and another is called a universal quantifier. Existential quantifier, and another is called a universal quantifier. Okay. Now, what is an existential quantifier? Existential quantifiers are basically phrases like, they are phrases like, there exists. I'm sure you would have seen a lot of statements containing this phrase, there exists. Am I right? There exists a prime number which is even, isn't it? Which chapter you have seen there exists and all? Sixth chapter maybe? Yeah. Or statements which begin with phrases like at least. Okay. At least. At least. At least dot dot dot. For example, if I say there exists at least one planet which has life on it. Okay, so that at least word is basically acting like an existential quantifier. The word has come from exist. Existential has come from the word exist. So you are basically trying to show that there exist certain quantities which basically have that characteristic as mentioned in the statement. Okay, or some. Okay, so even some. So some odd numbers are prime. So that word sum is acting like an existential quantifier. So what are universal quantifiers? Universal quantifiers are phrases which sound like this. For every or every, whatever you want to call it. Okay. For every X belonging to real number, X square is greater than equal to zero, right? So that for every basically acts like a universal quantifier. Or all, right? For example, if I say all equilateral triangles are isosceles. See, by the way, when I'm making a statement, I need not always make a true statement. My statement can be false also. Nevertheless, it is a statement. So many people say, sir, it is false. No, how it is a statement? Statement can be true. Statement can be false also. Okay. So don't always expect me to make true statements. Okay. Even words like none or no, none, etc. These are also universal quantifiers because they are taking the entire universe into their, you know, purview. For example, there's a statement like this. No one in Germany speaks German, or no one in Germany speaks English. Let's make some, you know, valid statement. No one in Germany speaks English. Okay, so here I'm just trying to cover every, you know, person living in Germany under that statement, right? Are you getting my point? So these are all called universal quantifiers. Okay. So when it comes to negation, of statements which begin with universal quantifier or existential quantifier, I've seen many people making mistakes. Okay. Now let me see whether you are making the same mistake or not. Okay. So let me ask a question to you. Let's see who all are able to answer this. So I have a statement here. All natural numbers are negative. All natural numbers are negative. Okay. Can anybody tell me what would be the negation of this statement? Write it down on the chat box. I would like to see your response on the chat box. All natural numbers are negative. Achindya, sorry, that's wrong. Satyam, not completely right, but you have made a good attempt. Arya, wrong. Harshita, wrong. See, I told you, many people make mistakes. Most of you are saying no natural number is negative, or all natural numbers are not negative. Okay, now here, please understand, all natural numbers are not negative. You know, to a certain extent, it is clear, but your sentence framing is not that correct. Okay, so here, please note that, yes, Aryan, correct. Here you know that your statement is starting with a universal quantifier. Okay, so this is a universal quantifier. Please note that whenever a statement starts with universal quantifier, even one instance of the population that you are referring to, if it is, you know, if it is not following what the statement is saying, then also the statement gets negated. For example, If I say all swans are white, and tomorrow you come and show me, sir, see this swan, this is black in color. So what happens to the statement which I gave you? It becomes false, right? You'll say, sir, your statement was false. I got a swan which is white. So I did not show every swan to, you need not show me every swan existing in this earth to show me that they are black or to show that they are not white. So even one instance you get where you realize that whatever I have said is not being followed, then that negates that statement. That is why I keep telling you every time that if you want to disprove something, one example is sufficient. But if you want to prove something, you need a generic proof. So here I'm trying to say all natural numbers are negative. That is my statement. So it is sufficient to say that there exists a natural number which is non-negative is good enough to negate my statement. Okay. So please note, if there is a universal quantifier in a statement, its negation would contain existential quantifier. So you could answer this question in the following ways. You can either say there exists a natural number which is non-negative. Need not say positive, because zero could also be, which is non-negative. Or you could say at least one natural number is non-negative. Okay, is non-negative. Or you could also use some natural numbers are non-negative. All of them will fetch you the marks. They're all the right answers. So they're all correct. Okay. But never say no natural number is negative. That is not going to work out. Your teacher will mark it wrong. Okay. Similarly, if I give you a statement which has got existential quantifier, for example, let's say another example I'm taking. R is a statement which says, There exists a prime number that is even. What do you think would be the negation of the statement? What do you think is the negation of the statement? There exists a prime number that is even. Neil, there exists a prime number that is even, and all prime numbers is even have something in common. They're not complementary. They're not negation of each other, right? There exists a prime number that is even. No, Vyani, you have not understood. There exists has an existential quantifier. There exists a prime number that is even. You need to tell me the complementary of that. Correct. Either you say there is no prime number that is even, or you say all prime numbers are odd. Okay, both are fine. So please note, this will start with a universal quantifier. So if there is an existential quantifier in the statement, its negation will have a universal quantifier. Either you say all prime numbers are odd, or there is no prime number which is even. Are you getting the point? Are you getting my point? So please understand this fact. I'll write one more answer to this. Either of the two you can use. There is no prime number. So this no acts like a universal quantifier. There is no prime number that is even. Okay. So you are making a universal statement here. Okay. So please understand here. The moral of the story is, so please note this down. The moral of the story is, if there is a statement which is having a universal quantifier, okay, its negation will contain a existential quantifier, okay, and vice versa. That means if a statement has a existential quantifier, its negation will contain a universal quantifier. Its negation will contain a universal quantifier. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns here? There was a question asked, I think, in one of the exams. Okay. We will take that question, but before that, I would also take a few basic ones. Let's start with this question. Okay, first of all, let me start with classification of sentences. So please categorize the following sentences. Please categorize the following sentences. So please use the following abbreviation. Don't write everything. If you think a sentence is an assertive sentence, you write an A for it. So please use the word alphabet A for assertive. Please use IM for imperative. That means a command or a request. Please use IN for interrogative. Any type of questioning is happening. And please use E for exclamatory. So any kind of a wish or any kind of a expression of sorrow, excitement, joy, etc. So first one, please put the question number. First one, what do you think? A, IM, IN, or E? Which category does it fall in? A, very good. So this is a assertive sentence because you're asserting Chandigarh is a state. Okay. I mean, it's a false assertion, but nevertheless, it's an assertion. Okay. New Delhi is the capital of India. Assertive. 23 is a prime number. Assertive. Rational numbers are real numbers. Very good. Assertive. There is always a real root of any quadratic equation. Assertive. It may be wrong also because, you need not have all real roots to a quadratic. Okay. Assertive. Very good. 15 has three prime numbers. Assertive. Okay. Now, what about 8th one? Anu, bring a glass of water for me. It's an imperative sentence where you are giving a, command to Anu. Where are you going? That is interrogative. Correct. Bravo. You fought very well. It's an exclamatory sentence. Okay. Is it fine? Anyways, these are just basic school level type of questions. Let's take this one. Write down the negation of the following statements. Let's start with the first one. Chennai is the capital of Tamil Nadu. What is going to be the answer? All right. Plain and simple. Don't complicate it by using unnecessary terms. So here you can say, Chennai is not the capital of Tamil Nadu. Okay. Second one, root 2 is not a complex number. So what will be the negation of it? Root 2 is a complex number. Very good. Okay, next one. All triangles are not equilateral. Now here be careful. Why be careful? Because your statement contains a universal quantifier. Okay. So all triangles are not equilateral. Okay, you're claiming that no, there is no equilateral triangle existing. Yes, so you can answer this in various ways. You can say there exists a triangle which is equilateral. Okay, there exists a triangle which is equilateral. There are several ways to answer it. Okay, you can also answer it like this. At least one triangle is equilateral. Okay. Or you can answer it like this. Some triangles are equilateral. Again, Arya, you are making the same mistake. All triangles are not equilateral. Its negation will start with existential quantifier. It should have an existential quantifier. What is this which I wrote? Statements having universal quantifier, negation should have an existential quantifier. Okay. So all triangles are not equilateral. The negation is not all triangles are equilateral or every triangle is equilateral. No. Even if one triangle becomes equilateral, it is good enough as a negation for it. Are you getting my point? What I'm trying to say? Okay. Next. The number 2 is greater than 7. What is the negation? Yeah, the number 2 is not greater than 7. Good enough. This is a simple statement. Nothing to worry about it. Doesn't have a quantifier involved. But yes, fifth one, again, you have to be careful. There is a quantifier sitting over here. Every natural number is an integer. Correct, Satyam. There exists a natural number which is not an integer. There exists a natural number. That is, or which is not an integer. Excellent. Okay. Or some natural numbers are not integers. Or at least one natural number is not an integer. All of them are perfectly okay. Is this fine? Any questions? Now let me give you the question which actually came in one of the competitive exams. The question was like that, this. Okay, let's say S is a non-empty subset of real numbers. Okay. And there is a statement P which says there is a rational number x belonging to S such that x is greater than 0. Okay. Which of the following is negation of P? Options. There is a rational number x belonging to S such that x is less than equal to 0. Option B. There is no rational number x belonging to S such that x is less than equal to 0. Every rational number x belonging to S satisfies x less than equal to 0. And finally, x belongs to s and x is less than equal to 0 implies x is not rational. Okay, which of the following do you think is the answer to this question? I'm putting the poll on. If you want, you can respond on the chat box as well. But I would also like to see your response on the poll so that I know what is the count of the people answering this question. Okay, I have got 8 responses so far. Sorry, 10 responses so far. Okay, should we stop the poll in the next 15-20 seconds? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Cool. Okay. So most of you have said option number C. Okay. D is of course not the answer. It is something else. So D is ruled out. Now let's try to see. Could A be the answer? See, there is already an existential quantifier. There is means existential quantifier. Okay. The word exist need not always exist. Okay. If you read this, you'll automatically know that there is something is there. That means there exists something. Okay. So this is an existential quantifier. So your negation of it must contain a universal quantifier like no or every, like that. Okay. So first one, there exists a real number which is less than equal to zero. Sorry, rational number which is less than equal to zero. This cannot be your answer. So those who are answering with A, sorry, this cannot be your answer. B, there is no rational number such that x is less than equal to zero. Basically, it is saying, trying to say the same thing, that there exists a rational number greater than zero, right? Are you getting my point? So option number B is basically having, it's basically talking about certain numbers which are greater than zero, which is almost rhyming with what P is saying, isn't it? So when you say there is no rational number lesser than equal to zero, that means there are some rational numbers which are greater than zero. Correct? In fact, you're trying to say that all of them are greater than zero. So there is, and all of them are greater than zero. Okay. Which basically rhymes with each other. So this cannot be the complementary, right? Complementary has to be exactly ulta. It cannot have some overlap with it. Like the way you have in sets, complementary set and the set cannot have an overlap. Are you getting my point? So this B option and this P statement will have some overlap. So this cannot be a complement of or negation of that statement. But if you say every rational number is less than zero, then this is exactly opposite of what is this. Okay. So if you're saying every rational number is lesser than or equal to zero, it cannot have any overlap with there is a rational number greater than zero. So option C is the right option. Are you getting my point? This problem came in one of the JE main exams. I think in 2010 or 11 it came. Is it fine? So please do not take the concept of negations lightly. Some very good questions have been framed on this. Now, With this, we are now going to move towards the concept of compound statements. Compound statements. Many of our concepts will be coming from this topic itself of compound statements. So what is a compound statement? So basically a statement. Let me define it first. A statement made of simpler statements. Okay. So if more than one simple statement has been connected in some format, what are those connectors? We will discuss it in some time. So the statement which is made up of some simpler statements, those are called compound statements. These simpler statements are actually called the substatements, also called as the component statements many a times. Also called as component statements. Okay. So what are the compound statements that we are going to talk about? Primarily, we are going to discuss only three types of compound statements. So what are the types of compound statements that we are going to talk about? Let's talk about them. We are going to talk about first statements which are connected by AND operator, which is called conjunctions. Okay. So these are statements which are connected by the AND operator. Okay, we'll talk about it in detail. Secondly, we are going to talk about disjunctions, also called alternations. These are those compound statements which are connected, or these are those compound statements where your substatements or component statements are connected by OR operator. We will talk about this also. And the last type of compound statements that we are going to talk about is called, are called implications. So there are two types of implications that we are going to talk about. If then implication and if and only if implication. Okay. By the way, if then implication is also called conditional statements. Okay. Remember, in your coding, you have some conditional blocks, if then block, that's actually called a conditional block. Yes or no? And if and only if is called biconditional statements. Biconditional statements. Okay. So primarily, these are the three types of statements that we are going to cover up. Conjunctions, disjunctions, implications. Of all the three, this is the most important one. Okay, this is the heavier of all the three. So please note this down. And we will start with conjunctions now. Do let me know once you are done with copying. Done, everybody? Done with the copy? Okay. Shall we go to the next slide? Wait, I know. Done. Okay. Done, Arya? Okay, conjunctions. So conjunctions are those statements where there are two simpler statements, or they could be more than two also. I'm just giving a simplistic example. They're connected by AND operator. So AND is basically a logical connector. Okay, we also call it as an operator also. Logical connector slash operator. Symbolically, we represent this entire thing by this symbol P and Q. Okay. Now, most of you would be thinking, sir, it is very similar to that intersection symbol which we use in our sets. Yes. In our sets, we used to have a downward opening, you can say, structure, but it is a slightly sharper one. Now, from where these symbols have come, actually, they have been borrowed from ancient times. Okay. Normally, if you see, if you read very ancient Greek literature and all, they used to use some symbols to represent something, right? So for male, female, child, they used to have some different types of symbols. Okay. So that has been taken away from there. I would not go to the historical part of it. So some examples which I can give here is, let's say, if I say 10 is divisible by 2 and 3. Okay. 10 is divisible by 2 and 3. So if you see, this is a compound statement. Okay. And is made up of two simpler statements. What are the two simpler statements here? 10 is divisible by 2. 10 is divisible by 2. And 10 is divisible by 3. 10 is divisible by 3. Okay. So you have connected them by a AND connector. But mind you, not all the statements which contain AND becomes a conjunction. Okay. At many places, AND doesn't act like a connector. Can you give me a statement where AND doesn't act like a connector? Can anybody give me a statement where AND doesn't act like a connector? Anybody? Need not be mathematical. Okay, let me give you. Fire and water do not go together. Do not go together. Okay, so here AND, if you remove, let's say if you read it like this, fire do not go together, water do not go together, it doesn't make any sense, right? So those statements would not qualify to become sentences also, because they don't convey a meaning. Okay, so here AND is a must. It is not made up of two component statements. Okay. Another example I can give you is, let's say, Ram and Shyam are friends. Ram and Shyam are friends. So here this AND is not acting like a conjunction. Okay, this is not a conjunction. So let me write it down. The following are not conjunctions. The following are not conjunctions. Another example which I can give you is, let's say, I watched this movie. I watched the movie, Mr. and Mrs. Let me write AND here to be more specific. Mr. and Mrs. Khanna. Okay. So here, if you see, the name of the movie itself contains AND. It is not acting like a connector. You can't say I watched the movie Mr. Khanna and I watched the movie Mrs. Khanna. Mr. and Mrs. Khanna is the name of that particular movie. It's the title of that movie. So these are not conjunctions. So please do not start claiming every statement which has got AND into it as conjunctions. Okay. Now, what is the truth table of this conjunction? Many of you are already aware of it, but I'll still make it for you. So let's say P, Q, P, and Q. The truth table goes like this. Achha, by the way, when you have two component statements, how many entries or how many permutation combinations of truth values you require over here? 4, correct. So you can have true, 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 false, false, true, false, false. So 4 inputs are required. Okay. So how does this 4 input come up? Very simple. Every component statement can have 2 truth values. Every component statement can have 2 truth values. Either it could be true or false. So if there are 2 component statements, PQ, then you will need 4 combinations of these truth values. True, 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 false, false, true, false, false. If there were 3 component statements, then how many combinations would have been needed? 8. If 4 component statements would have been there, then how many combinations would have been there? 16. Okay. So the formula is 2 to the power n. Okay. Anyways. So this is a truth table. This is how a compound statement works. If both the statements, component statements are true, then the compound statement P and Q is true. If one of them is false, it is going to become false. Okay. So only when both of them are true, so the only occasion when a conjunction will be true is when both the component statements or the sub-statements making that conjunction are true. Okay, this is already known to you, so I will not be wasting that much time. Even the people who have taken bio, I'm sure you would have done this in your junior computer science class 9, 10th. Haven't you? 1 into 1 is 1, 0 into 1 is 0, 0, 1 into 0 is 0, 0 into 0 is 0. That same concept is there. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns related to a conjunction? Is this fine? Can I go to the next one? Disjunction? Copied? Okay. So the second type of statement, compound statement that you normally get to see in your competitive exams are disjunctions, also called as alternations. Okay. So what is a disjunction? Disjunction is when the two component statements are connected by OR connector. Okay. But now please note that there are two types of OR connectors. So please note, OR connectors are of two types. One is called exclusive OR. Okay. And another type of OR operator is inclusive OR operator. Now, what is an exclusive OR? Exclusive OR basically means if one happens, the other cannot happen. Okay, so they can happen only one at a time. For example, if I use a statement having exclusive OR, it would sound something like this. A number is either positive or negative. As you can see, this is an exclusive OR because the number cannot be positive, negative at the same time. Yes or no? Yes or no? Either the coffee is hot or cold. Cannot be hot, cold simultaneously. Okay. Or you can also say like this, the students are in class or in playground. Okay. So as you can see here, the students cannot be simultaneously in the class and the playground. So this OR is acting like a exclusive OR. So if one happens, the other will not happen. Are you getting my point? Clear? Whereas inclusive OR is where both the options are possible. For example, let's say either the bus is not moving or my watch is slow. Okay, so let's say you're traveling somewhere and you realize that, you know, you have not reached the destination. So you will say either the bus is not moving or my watch is, there's some problem with my watch. Okay. So both can happen actually simultaneously. The bus may not be moving and your watch may be slow also, right? So one doesn't exclude the occurrence of the other. Are you getting my point? So both can also happen, right? So union, you can say yes. Union is basically a type of an inclusive OR because every element either can fall in A or fall in B or in both of them, right, Satya? Okay, another example I can give is, I would prefer tea or coffee. Okay, that means even if you bring both of them to me, I can have both of them. Okay, it's not like if I drink tea, I cannot drink coffee. If I drink coffee, I cannot drink tea. I can have both the beverages. Is it fine? Now, our discussion will be around this. We will be not discussing this. This is not in our syllabus. Okay. We'll only restrict our understanding to inclusive OR. So inclusive OR is symbolized by up arrow, down arrow. Okay. So the down arrow is used to symbolize OR connector between two simple statements. Up arrow is used to signify AND connector between two simple statements. Is it fine? Up arrow, down arrow. Please be clear about it. So there is a way to remember it also. Union, if you just try to make the, U sharp like this, okay? Or intersection, if you try to like this, okay? So this acts like a inclusive OR, and this acts like your AND. Okay? So this is how normally I also used to remember when I was in my preparation days, right? So what is the truth table of an inclusive OR? For an inclusive OR, the truth table goes like this. Let's say these are the four status.
Okay, I found this on the web for these are the four.
So true or true is true. True or false is true. False or true is true. False or false is false. That means the only occasion when a disjunction becomes false is when both the component statements are false. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Many examples can be cited. I would just like to cite one example for a conjunction. Disjunction example. Let's say I say 15 is or 10 is divisible by 2 or 5. Okay. That means it could be divisible by both also. Okay. So inclusive, this OR is an inclusive OR, even though we do not explicitly write it. Is it fine? Okay. Now with this, I'll be running you through certain algebra of sets and certain terms, which are going to be very important for us. So let us move into that. And then I will move towards the idea of implications. Okay. So I'll be now taking you. Yes, sure. I will show the truth table. So now I will be taking you to certain algebra of statements or rules of statements. Okay. And then I will be moving towards the concept of implication. Done, everybody? Okay. So algebra of statements. Now, when I'm giving you this algebra of statements, you would all be reminded of your set chapter. Okay. In set chapter, more or less the same algebra is applicable. So you'll hardly find any difference. Okay. That's why it becomes very easy for us to remember them also. So the first one is idempotent law. Idempotent law. Almost like the same idempotent laws that we learned in our sets. So if you take a statement P and AND it with another statement P, that means you take a conjunction of P with itself, it is going to give you P itself. Now, all of you, please make note over here. I have used a special symbol over here. Okay. This symbol, let me just talk about it before I proceed. This symbol, or many times books will use this symbol, or in some cases, they will use this symbol also, okay? But normally this symbol is a symbol which is going to be used later on. So let us not use it right now. So these two symbols are normally used to signify logical equivalence. What is the meaning of logical equivalence? Means having the same truth table. So in the eyes of mathematics, two statements are logically equivalent if they have the same truth table. That means I claim that if you make a truth table for this and you make a truth table for this, they will exactly be the same. That is why these two statements are logically equivalent, or these two WFFs, the well-formed formulas, they are logically equivalent to each other. So you will see this symbol being used multiple times by me. Okay, if they're not logically equivalent, normally we cross it. After writing it, we cross it. That is called not logically equivalent. Okay, for example, if I write something like this, three dashes, many times it is used for identity also. If you open your international books, you'll see that they use this for identity. So they will say cos square theta plus sine square theta, they'll put three dashes and put a one. That means whether you say cos square theta plus sine square theta or whether you say one, they're both same, they mean the same thing. That is why they say it's an identity also. So if you cross it, it means they are not logically equivalent. Not logically equivalent. Okay. Is this fine? So this is something which I'll be using time and again. I hope there is no confusion about that. Okay. So P and P is logically equivalent to P. Please do not write equal to and all. In case of statements, we don't write equal to. Equal to doesn't make sense. Equal to is used for numbers. Okay. Numbers or maybe the expressions in your algebra. In logical statements, we don't use equal to. Similarly, P or P is logically equivalent to P. Okay. So these two laws are called the idempotent laws. Note this down. The second law is associative laws. So what are these associative laws? Just like you have learned in your sets chapter, if you do P and Q, okay, and R, it is logically equivalent to this. Okay. That means it doesn't matter whether you associate P and Q first and then take AND operator with R. Right. So even if you do Q and R AND first and then take AND with P, the result is still the same. In fact, the order of ANDing doesn't matter. Okay. In any order, you random order also, you can pair them up. Similarly goes with disjunction also. P or Q or R is logically equivalent to saying this. Okay. See, all of these you have already done. It is just a formal application of it to statements as well. Next is your distributive law. Distributive laws. Distributive law is also very much similar to what we had learned. So you have a distribution of or over and. So you can always write this like this. Okay. Or you could have a distribution of AND over OR. Okay, same as what we had for union and intersections. Next. Next is your involution laws. Involution law. So involution law is simple. Negation of a negation gives you the same statement back. Obviously, isn't it? So the negation of a negation will bring you the same. So if you do even number of negations, you are back to the same statement. Yes or no? So this is called involution law. And De Morgan's law, which is something which you have already done in your sets, that is yet again coming up in this chapter also, De Morgan's laws. So De Morgan's law says that if you take a negation of a conjunction, it is logically equivalent to saying negation P or negation Q. Okay. Just like we had A intersection B complement equal to A complement union B complement. Okay. In the same way, P and Q negation is P negation, Q negation connected by OR operator. Getting my point? So AND here becomes OR applied between the negations. Getting the point? Similarly, negation of P or Q is logically equivalent to negation P and negation Q. Just like we had A union B complement equal to A complement intersection B complement. Okay. So this will help you to remember the results here. Is it fine? Any questions? Now, what are the proof for this? All of them can very be easily proved by truth table. Okay. Can be very easily proved. Easily proved by use of truth tables. Okay. So you can make truth tables for the left hand side and the right hand side, and you'll realize that they become logically equivalent. Is this right? So these are the laws. Now I'll be telling you certain terms which you'll be coming across. So first note this down, and if you have any questions, any concerns, do let me know. Let us do one thing. Let us prove the fifth one just as a practice. Okay. So let us prove De Morgan's law applied to statements by using truth tables. Have you all copied this? Can I go to the next slide? Done? Copied? Okay. Okay. So let's prove one of them. Just the first part. P and Q negation is logically equivalent to negation P or negation Q. Okay. So what I will do is, I'll make a truth table. In this truth table, I will make P, Q, negation P, negation Q, P and Q, negation of P and Q, and finally, negation of P or negation Q. So let me write it down. So P, Q, negation P, negation Q, P and Q, negation of P and Q, and finally, negation P or negation Q. That is your right hand side. Okay. So there are two sub statements here, or two component statements here. So I will require four inputs: true, 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 false, false, true, false, false. Correct. So if this is your P, what is your negation P? Can somebody tell me? Write it down on the chat box. What should I write? False. False, true, true. Okay. What should I write for here? False, true, false, true. Very good. What should I write for P and Q? True, false, false, false. What is the negation of it? False, true, true, true. Now take the disjunction of negation P and negation Q. Or take the or operator between them. So F or F is F. F or T is T. T or F is again T. T or T is T. What do you see here is that they have the same table. No difference. So basically it signifies that these two will have the same TT. Same TT means they are logically equivalent. That means if you say negation of P and Q, it is as good as saying negation P or negation Q. Got the point? So basis of this, let's take few questions. Let's take few questions. Is it clear? The proof is clear by using truth tables. Any questions here? All right. So let's take a small question based on the same. The negation of 2 plus 3 equal to 5 and 8 less than 10 is which of the following? So I'm putting the poll on. I would request everybody to answer. Very easy question. I'm giving you around 45 seconds. Okay, Satyam, we'll see. Waiting for at least 70% of the people to answer. Come on, guys, this is not a rocket science. You should all get it. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. All right. So 11 of you have responded only. Most of you have said option number C. That's absolutely right. So you can call this statement to be, let's say, P. P is saying 2 plus 3 is 5. And you can call this statement to be Q. 8 is less than 10. So what you have to do is you have to write down the negation of P and Q, right? Because these two statements are connected by AND operator. So as per our De Morgan's law, it is negation P or negation Q. So how would you read negation P? Negation P means 2 plus 3 is not equal to 5. This symbol is standing for OR. Negation Q means 8 is not less than 10. So option number C is absolutely right. Any questions? Okay, let's try one more. These are all simple ones. Again, 30 seconds to answer this question as well. What is the negation of this statement? Ram is in class 10th or Rashmi is in class 12th? Ram is in class 10th or Rashmi is is in class 12. Yes, almost 1.5 minutes gone. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, let me end the poll. Most of you have gone with option number B. B for Bengaluru. See, these two statements are connected by OR operator. So the answer to this question is Ram is not in class 10th and Rashmi is not in class 12th. Correct? So if I say P is a statement where Ram is in class 10th, and let's say Q is a statement where you're saying Rashmi is in class 12th. Okay. What you have to find out, you have to find out negation of this. Correct? And as per our De Morgan's law, it is negation of P and negation of Q, which means to say Ram is not in class 10th and Rashmi is not in class 12th. Okay, I'm sorry. Ram is not in class 10th and Rashmi is not in class 12th. Okay. Now, out of these four options, which option do you think is the most appropriate? Ram is not in class 10, but Ram is in class 12th. Illa. Ram is not in class 10th, but Rashmi is not in class 12th. What is this but doing? It should be and, right? So I don't think so. You should mark this also. Now, I mean, if they would have said neither Ram is in class 10th nor Rashmi is in class 12th, that also is acceptable. That is also is a correct way of saying Ram is not in class 10th and Rashmi is not in class 12th. Okay. But if you see C1, either Ram is not in class 10th or Ram is not in class 12th, that is doesn't make sense. So as per me, the appropriate answer here should be none of these, none of the above. Are you getting my point? But, you know, please apply your English, bit of English knowledge also, but not to a very large extent. Many a times the question setter will be very clear about the options. It will not be very dubious. It will not be very, we can say, you know, vague option given to you. They're very clear about it. Okay. So if you see your previous year questions on this topic, their options are pretty, you know, clear, unambiguous. Okay. All right. Now, apart from this, there are terms which you need to know. So few important terms. Okay. With respect to statements. With respect to statements. One term that you will keep on coming across is tautology. Anybody knows what's a tautology? Anybody has heard of this term, tautology? Right, Satyam is correct. So it's a statement which is always true. Statement which is always true. So for a tautology, if you see the truth table, all the entries in the truth table of a tautology will always be true, 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 true. Okay. For example, something like this, P or not P. If you make a truth table for this, let me make one quickly. It will not take much of a time. So let's say P, not P, and P or not P. So let's say this is true, false, then this will be false, true. Now true or false is true, false or true is also true. So as you can see, this is always true. This is always true. And in that case, this statement becomes a tautology. Okay. Second kind of term that you will commonly see is a contradiction. Contradiction, many places you will see fallacy. Okay. So contradiction or fallacy is a statement which is always false. A statement which is always false. Which is always false. A simple example of this could be P and not P. However, we'll be solving many questions where you will come across, you know, complicated examples also of tautology and fallacy. Okay. So if I make a truth table again, just like I made for the above one, P, not P, P and not P. So if this is true, false, this will be false, true. Now remember, true and false is a false. False and true is again a false. So this is always false. So this statement is a contradiction. So basically you're trying to say P and not P also. Something like saying 3 is a prime number and 3 is not a prime number. So this statement will always be false because both are contradicting each other, isn't it? Okay. So P and not P is a contradiction or is a fallacy. The third type of term that you will see is a contingency. Contingency is basically a statement which is neither a tautology nor a fallacy, nor a contradiction. A statement which is neither a tautology, nor a fallacy. That means sometimes it will be true, sometimes it will be false. It cannot be true always. It cannot be false always. It will have a mix and match of true and false. Something like P or Q, that's a contingency. P and Q, that's also contingency. Some occasions it was true, some occasions it was false. So just remember like this, if it is not a tautology or a fallacy, it is a contingency. Okay. The fourth term that you will get to hear is a dual statement or a duality. Dual statement, also called as a duality. Now, what is a duality of a statement, or what is a dual statement of a statement? So let's say, let me symbolize it. Let's say there is a statement which has got P and Q as the component statements. And of course, this may have a lot of, you can say, connectors like AND connector, OR connector, etc. Then the duality of this is represented by S star PQ. Okay, this is just a symbol that we use. And how is the duality obtained? Duality is obtained by replacing AND with OR, and OR with AND in your statement given to you. Okay. So for example, if I say, let me give an example. If I say, can you write the duality of this statement? Okay. So let's say, if I say, write the dual statement of the following. Okay. So somebody asks you, what is the dual statement of this? So you will say P. Now there's a AND connector, so put an OR there. Okay. And there is an OR connector, so put an AND there. So this will become your answer for the duality. Clear? Very simple. Okay. Nothing to worry about it. So some questions have been asked to write down the dual statement of a particular statement. So all you need to do is change AND with OR with AND. That's it. Don't have to change negation and all. Please note that many people start removing negations also. Okay. One of the very interesting properties of duality is this property. If you have a statement with component statements as, let's say, P, Q, R, etc. I'm just writing three of them. If you're taking the negation of it, then please note that the negation will be logically equivalent to the duality with the inputs as negation of these component statements. This is a very, very important property. Please note this down. Some questions have been framed around this property in the competitive exams also. So any statement's negation is logically equivalent to its dual statement, but written in terms of negation of the component statements. One of the examples you have already seen while I was giving you the De Morgan's law. I'll show that again. First, copy this down. Negation of a statement is nothing but, or it is logically equivalent to, its dual statement, but written in terms of negation of the component statements. Okay, so now let me show this example to you. Do you remember when I told you De Morgan's law? What was De Morgan's law? De Morgan's law gave you this, correct? Correct? Let's say P and R, you're taking a negation of it. It becomes negation P or negation R. Okay. Now let's try to understand it like this. If I gave you this statement, just this statement, what is the duality of this? What is the duality of this guy? P or Q or R, correct? No. Now in this duality, if you replace this is your S, let's say, then this is your S star. Correct. In this S star, if you replace P with negation P, And R with negation R. Sorry, I wrote a Q by mistake. I should write an R. Normally, I keep writing P and Q only. So, yeah. So when you do this, what do you end up getting? You end up getting negation P or negation R. Correct? So what does it mean? It means that this particular property is coming from this itself. So negation of P and R is as good as the duality constructed with negation P, negation R. So if this duality I constructed with, I replace this with negation P and I replace this with negation R, I end up getting the negation of this guy. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? Okay, let me give you another example. So let us say I give you a statement, P or Q and R. Okay. And I ask you, what do you think is the negation of this statement? So what I will do is, I will save a lot of my time. First, I will write the duality of this guy. What is the duality of this guy? P and Q or R, correct? And what I will do is I will replace all my P, Q and R with negations. So it will become negation P and negation Q or negation R. Got the point? So this law helps you to save a bit of time when you are writing the negations of WFF, which has got these and or connectors in between. Okay, if there are many of them, you can immediately save your time on writing them. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Clear? Everybody, it is clear? All right, let's take problems. Now that we have done enough amount of concepts, we are good to start with problems. Okay, let's take this question. Let P and Q be two statements. Negation P or Q and negation P and negation Q is a option A tautology contradiction. Neither tautology nor contradiction means a contingency, or both tautology and contradiction. Of course, D is wrong option. But let me just launch the poll and take your response. The best way is to make a truth table. So make a truth table for this statement or this WFF and see whether the truth table is showing true, 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 true. Or false, or is a mix and match. And then give your response. Okay, 2 minutes gone. I can see almost 2.5 minutes gone. I can see only 5 of you have responded. I can give you 30 more seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, cool. Okay, end of poll. Out of 8 of you who voted, 5 of you say C and 3 of you say it's a contradiction. Okay, so let us make a truth table. So P, so I can only see 2 component statements here, P and Q. So P, Q, negation P, negation Q, negation P or Q, negation P and negation Q, and finally the original statement. So P, Q, negation P, negation Q, then negation P or Q, and we have negation P and negation Q, and finally our statement. Okay, so let's put some truth values. True, 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 false, false, true, false, false. Okay, negation of it will be false, false, true, true. Negation of this will be false, true, false, true. Now, you have to take this, these two and take their negation P and Q. You have to take their OR operator. Okay. So their OR operation will give you true, false, true, true. Correct? Now, just erase this off. Now you need to take AND between negation P and negation Q. So you have to AND these two guys. So false and false is false. False and true is also false. True and false is false. True and true is a true. Now these two fellows you have to take AND. So true, false, 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 and you realize the last one becomes a true. So because of this, it will neither be a tautology nor a contradiction. So it is actually C option. It's a contingency. It's a contingency. Okay. Please note this down. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? All fine? Let's take another one. Okay. Let's take this question. It came in VIEEE. VIEEE. Relaunch. What is the negation of this statement? What is the negation of this statement? All right, 2 minutes gone. 8 people have responded. So I'm switching off the poll in the count of 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. All right, so 9 of you have voted, out of which 7 of you say option number B. Now for such kind of question, you should always take the help of duality. Okay, duality gives you the negation in a much faster way. Remember the formula which I gave you? Duality of any statement like this, okay, whatever is, I mean, I'm just writing two of them because there are only two component statements here, is equal to the duality written in terms of negation of the component statement. Okay, so let's use this. So let's write down the duality of this. So duality of this guy, so S star, first let us write that down. That's right. Let me write it. Yeah, S star of this will be negation P or Q and P or negation Q. Correct? So this is the duality. This is the dual of this. Now in the dual, you replace P with negation P. So it will become negation negation P, which is P, negation Q, negation P again, negation negation Q will become Q. So this is your answer to this question. Which option does it match with? Which option does it match with? Option B, exactly. So B is the right option. How much time it takes? Okay. So just write down the dual of that given statement. In the dual of that given statement, how do you write the dual? Replace and with or with and. And in the dual, you replace your component statement with the negations. So P will become negation P, Q will become negation Q. Yes or no? Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Let's move on to the next one. Let's take this one. Which is the dual of the statement? Since we discussed about dual also, let's take this one also. What is the dual of the statement? I'm launching the poll. It should not take you more than 30 seconds. Okay, let me stop the poll now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have said option number B, B for Bengaluru. It's very obvious. So P, up arrow will be replaced with down arrow. Again, up arrow will be replaced with down arrow. Nothing else will change. Again, down arrow will be replaced with up arrow. That means and. So this is going to be your answer. Which option matches with this? Option number B or matches with this? So this is the dual of this statement. Are you getting my point? Okay. All right. So with this, we are now going towards the third type of compound statement, which we discussed, which was called the implications. And as I already told you, there are two types of implication, which is called if-then implication. So I'll be starting with my if-then implication, which is also called conditional statements. Okay. Now, many times you would have, you know, use if then in mathematics. If you drop a perpendicular from the center onto the chord, then it will bisect the chord. Correct? If a number is divisible by 4, it must be divisible. Then it should be divisible by 2. right? So these kind of statements which you keep using, keeps, you know, reading, they are called conditional statements. So something like which says, if this, then this. Okay. By the way, this is not only the only way to write a conditional statement. Many a time the same thing is written like this. P implies Q. They're same things, no difference. Whether you say if P then Q or whether you say P implies Q, it's the same thing, no difference. And you'll be surprised to know this is also read as P is the sufficient condition for Q. P is the sufficient condition for Q. Right? So all these three means the same thing. Even one more way of writing it, I will show you. Some books will also write it like this. Q is the necessary condition for P. Necessary condition for P. Okay. They mean the same. They all mean the same. Same meaning. Okay. So let me give you some examples. Let me give you some examples. Then you will understand the relevance of using these different phrases for signifying the same thing. So if P then Q, or if somebody says P implies Q, or if somebody says P is the sufficient condition for Q, or if somebody says Q is the necessary condition for P, they all have the same meaning in mathematics. Note it down, everybody. Okay, so let me give an example. If I give you an example, if it is a Sunday, then school is closed. Okay. So please note that being a Sunday is a sufficient condition for the school to be closed. In the sense that if somebody comes and tells you, hey, today is Sunday, then what image will you get regarding the functioning of the school? You'll automatically imagine closed gates, school is closed. Correct? So just mentioning a Sunday is sufficient enough for you to make it out that the school is closed, right? Of course, provided this statement is true. So I'm assuming under the assumption that whatever statement I've given, it's a true statement. Okay. Now please note that Q is not the sufficient condition for P. That means if the school is closed, it may not be a Sunday. Are you getting my point? So if somebody comes and tells you, hey, let's say I'm talking to Arya. I say, hey, Arya, your school is closed. So does it mean, Arya, that it will be a Sunday? No, it could be closed. Yeah, it could be closed because of so many reasons. Maybe, you know, a new variant of Corona is there in the market or in the town or in the city. Or it could be like, yeah, it could be like Gandhi Jayanti holiday. Or it could be like there is a leopard in the town. I think one school was closed because there was a leopard inside the school. Okay. So if I say it is a Sunday, it is sufficient enough for you to guess the school will be closed. But if I say the school is closed, it may not be a Sunday. Are you getting my point? But now the school being closed is a necessary condition for it to be a Sunday. That means if the school is not closed, then it is not Sunday. Are you getting my point here? Please understand this. This is deep, slightly deep to understand. If the school is not closed, if I come and tell you, hey, the school is not closed, then today can definitely be not a Sunday. Am I right? Because if it was a Sunday, the school would have been closed. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? See, I'll give you another example. Let's say if you have fever, Correct. If you have fever, you are definitely not healthy. Are you getting the point? But if you don't have a fever, that still doesn't mean you are healthy. You could have some other problem, maybe, you know, some other issues. Correct. But having a fever in the body is a significant of the fact that you are definitely not healthy. Correct. So fever becomes a sufficient condition to say that you are not healthy. Are you getting my point? But if you don't have a fever, it doesn't mean you are actually healthy. Right? So in the same way, if the school is not closed, it is a necessary condition that today will be not a Sunday. Because if it were a Sunday, the school would have been closed. Now remember when I was talking about circles the other day, what did I tell you? In a circle, the necessary condition is the coefficient of x square and y square should be equal. Right? So if the coefficients are not equal, x square and y square, it is definitely not a circle. But that doesn't mean if the coefficients are equal, it will be a circle. No, it can be parabola also. It can be ellipse also. We'll see in the other conic section chapter. So having the coefficient of x square and y square equal to 1 is a necessary condition for it to be a circle. If that is not met, necessary means very important. If that is not met, it will not be a circle. For example, another example I'll give you. Oxygen is a necessary element for my survival. Right? Oxygen is necessary for my survival. That means if oxygen is not there, I will definitely not survive. But that doesn't mean if oxygen is there, I will survive always. No, I can die because of other factors also. Maybe because of thirst, food, because of food. Right? So oxygen is necessary. Necessary thing means if that is not there, then the other guy will not happen. Right? It is not sufficient. That means if you give me oxygen, I will always survive. No. I may die because of other reasons. Sorry, maybe looking like a negative example. Right? So if the school is not closed, then it is not a Sunday. That is the meaning of the school is closed becomes a necessary condition for it to be a Sunday. Are you getting a point? Are you clear about the difference between the word sufficient and necessary? So necessary has to always be read in negation. For example, if I say it is a Sunday, then the school is closed, then Sunday is a sufficient condition, because if it is a Sunday, it is automatically implying that the school is closed. But if I say school is closed is a necessary condition for it to be a Sunday, means if the school is not closed, then it will not be a Sunday. Idea is clear. Initially, many people take time to understand this. Okay. Now, symbolically, we write this as P, and we put a single facing arrow towards Q. So this is a implies single facing arrow. Okay. So P implies Q, or P is the sufficient condition for Q, or Q is the necessary condition for P. They all mean the same thing. No difference. Correct. Now, there are certain words which you need to understand. Let's say if I call this to be R, then there are certain terms which you will keep hearing time and again. For example, converse of R. I'm sure you would have heard of this converse. In class 10th, do you remember your teacher used to always prove converse of a statement? Right? I used to be, very, very agitated. Why the teacher is doing converse? Isn't they mean the same thing? Okay, they actually don't mean the same thing. We'll talk about it through truth tables. So when I say there is a statement if P then Q, then the converse of it will be if Q then P. Now tell me, out of common sense, I'm asking you, of course, we will be figuring it out a little later on. If P then Q, if it is true, does it mean if Q then P will also be true? Do you think like that? Satyam is saying no. Right. For example, if I say, if a number is divisible by 9, then it will be divisible by 3. We all know it is a true statement. Correct? Any number which is divisible by 9, that number will also be divisible by 3. But can I say the converse is true? That means if a number is divisible by 3, it will be divisible by 9. Can I say that? No, I cannot. Because 6 or 3 itself, they're not divisible by 9. Okay. So please remember, when your teachers in the junior classes used to prove converse of a statement separately, they had an agenda. They had a point for doing it. Right? Because the statement and its converse need not be the same. Okay. Anyways, the next thing that you will keep reading is inverse of the statement. Inverse of the statement is read as if not P, then not Q. Okay. This is called the inverse of the statement. And there's something called contrapositive of the statement. Contrapositive is read like this. If not Q, then not P. Okay. We will see the truth tables of all these in some time. Okay. Let me first ask you a simple, very, very simple question. Okay. A very simple set of questions I have chosen for this. Read this question. This says, write down the contrapositive and converse of these following statements. Okay. The first statement says, if it is a prime number, then X is odd. Please tell me contrapositive of this. We'll not do everything. Maybe we'll do first one, second one. And let's say fourth one. Yeah. Tell me the contrapositive for this. Please write it down on your chat box. Today I will ask you to do some check typing activity. So tell me the contrapositive and tell me the converse. Contrapositive is right there on your screen. Contrapositive means if not Q, then not P. By the way, first in this statement, if X is a prime, then X is odd. Please note that P is X is a prime number and Q is X is odd. So what is contrapositive of this? Correct. Contrapositive is if not Q, that means if X is not odd, then not P, that means then X is not prime number. It is not a prime number. Is it fine? Is it fine? Okay. Next one. Converse. Converse is this. If Q, then P. So how would you write the converse for this? If X is odd, right, then X is a prime number. Simple. Nothing hard and fast. Okay, we'll quickly do the second one also. I think two of them is sufficient. We don't have to do even the fourth one also. So please complete the second one. What is the contrapositive here? Contrapositive and converse. Yeah. If the two lines are parallel, then they do not intersect in the same plane. So how would you write the contrapositive? If the two lines are parallel, then they do not intersect in the same plane. If the two lines intersect in the same plane, then they are parallel. Correct? Then the two lines are parallel. Anything you can write, then they are parallel also. I'm just saving some, you know, writing time. That's why I'm not writing everything. Is it fine? Then they're not parallel. Sorry. Then they're not parallel. Correct. Yeah. Is this fine? So if not Q, then not P. Okay. What is the converse of this? What is the converse of this? If the two lines do not intersect in the same plane, intersect in the same plane. Okay, then they are parallel. Okay, this is called the converse. So any doubt related to what is converse? Okay, let me do one more example here. The first one, can you tell me the inverse also? Let's take one more inverse. This is from my side, even though the question is not asking you. Write down the inverse of the first one. If x is a prime, then x is odd. What is the inverse of this statement? Write, Satyam. If x is not prime, then x is not odd. Or x is even. Okay, whatever. Is this fine? Any questions? Now, before I take a break, I would take a break after giving you the truth table of if P then Q. Okay, so every kind of a compound statement, we should know the truth table. Okay. So let me go to the next screen. Truth tables. So I will write the truth table for all of them and in the same go. Why to write it separately? So converse, inverse, contrapositive. And we will analyze it also. Okay. We will do the analysis part also. So please pay attention, everybody. Initially, many people find this table to be slightly weird. Okay. But let me justify the reason for the table. Okay. So let me ask you the question first of all. So I'm focusing first of all on this guy, P implies Q table. Okay. Since there are two component statements, there will be four inputs, TT, TF, FT, TFF. Correct. Now, if P and Q both are true. Achha, by the way, I forgot to tell you the name which we use for P and Q. Let me go to the previous slide. I'll come back to it. Just give me a second. P is called the antecedent. Okay. Sometimes also called hypothesis. It's a name given to P. Q is called the consequent. Sometimes it is also called conclusion. Okay. So here I'm making a truth table. Oh, sorry. I'm making a truth table for if P then Q. Now you tell me, everybody think and tell me, if the antecedent and consequent both are true, will that statement if P then Q, will it be true? For example, let's say I gave you a statement. If it is a Sunday, then the school is closed. Correct? Now you woke up on a Sunday. That means it is a Sunday. You went to the school and you realize it is closed. That means both antecedent and consequent are happening. Then will you call me and tell me, sir, your statement was true? Or will you call me and tell me, sir, your statement was false? What will you call and tell me? We'll definitely say, sir, your statement was true. Aap sahi bol rahe the. You were right. So today is a Sunday. I came to school and I realized that the school is closed. So whatever you were saying is true. Yes or no? Correct? No. But what if you realize that today is a Sunday, let's say on a Sunday morning, you went up and you realize that the school is functioning. Immediately you will ring me up and tell me what, sir, you were saying false or true. What will you say? You're saying false, isn't it? Yes or no? Why only one person is answering? See, I gave you a statement that if it is a Sunday, then the school is closed. On a Sunday, let's say being a Sunday, that is true. You went to school, but the school is not closed. So false means it is functioning. It is open. So you will call me and tell me what? Sir, whatever you said, that statement was true or that statement was false, what will you say? You'll say it's a false, no? Because the school is functioning. Correct? Now, you went on a non-Sunday, let's say Monday. You went to the school and the school was closed. Then will you call me and say you were true or will you call me and say you were false? Correct, Satyam. Correct, Arnav. Arnav, you have already done this in school also. Correct. This answer is actually true. My statement still holds to be true because I said if it is a Sunday, then the school is closed. You went on a Monday. That is none of my problem. It is closed, open. I don't care. I mean, my statement is not bound to, you know, become wrong because of that. I said if it is a Sunday, if antecedent is not satisfied, then I don't care about the consequent. Whether the school is open or the school is closed, my statement still is valid. My statement still holds. So my statement is still true. Are you getting my point? Yes or no? Okay. Now, if let's say it is a non-Sunday, let's say Monday, and the school is open, does my statement become false because of this? No, it is still going to be true. So please, everybody, note down this truth table because you'll be using this very, very frequently in solving the problem. Okay. Now, many people ask me, sir, can you tell me a trick to remember this? Okay. So normally I tell them a story that, let's say, there's a husband, okay, who promises his wife that if I get a promotion, then I will take you to Singapore. Then I will take you to Singapore. Okay. For a holiday vacation. Okay. Now, if this husband gets a promotion and he takes his wife, basically it is the first case. Correct? Is he a good husband? If yes, write a true. If he's a bad husband, write a false. Okay. So, first case is he gets the promotion, he takes his wife to Singapore. Is he a good husband? Of course, yes. He fulfilled his promise. So true for this. Okay. If he gets the promotion, that means it is the first part becomes true. The antecedent becomes true, but he doesn't take his wife to Singapore. Right? He wants to save money and all. So what kind of husband is he? Bad husband, right? So false. Isn't it? If he doesn't get a promotion, he still takes his wife to Singapore. That is the third part. He's a very good person. Like despite he not getting promotion, he still took his wife out to Singapore for a vacation. So he's a very good husband, in fact, isn't it? Yeah. And the fourth case is he doesn't get promotion. He did not get promotion. He did not take his wife. Fine. It doesn't make him a bad person, right? Because probably he doesn't have money. I mean, promotion comes with a lot of, you know, extra remuneration. And he did not get that. So he did not, you know, take his wife to Singapore. So still is a good person, right? So this is why it is true. Is this fine? Any questions? Any question related to the truth table? Now let us quickly complete the truth table for the others as well. So now I will draw the truth table simultaneously for the converse, for the inverse, and for the contrapositive. Now watch out the truth table very, very carefully. Okay. A lot of things we will take away from that. See here. Now Q becomes your antecedent. P becomes your consequent. Okay. So now read this statement in a reverse direction. Husband getting promotion, taking his wife to Singapore. Good husband. Yes. Did not get a promotion, still took his wife to Singapore. Good husband. Got a promotion, did not take his wife. Finished. Right? Bad husband, so it's false. Did not get a promotion, did not take his wife. Still a good person, so true. Now, do you realize that these truth tables are different from each other? Right? So what is the conclusion here? The conclusion here is P implies Q. So number one conclusion is P implies Q is not logically equivalent to Q implies P. And that is the main reason why our teachers in our junior classes used to prove converse of a statement separately. Okay. I used to be very, very agitated. Ma'am, you are wasting time. I'm doing the same thing reverse and all those things. Then I realized after doing this chapter that, oh, my teacher was right. She used to prove the converse also, because the statement and its converse need not be equivalent. Yes, correct. Right? I used to be very, very agitated. I used to tell my friends, oh, ma'am is wasting time and all this. Sometimes you realize, you know, what our elders do little later on in our life. So when we keep saying, no, study hard, UTs, don't overindulge in UT and all, you'll realize it later on. Anyways, coming back. Sir, you are giving philosophy also with logics. Eh? Next, not P implies not Q. So let's make a table for not P and not Q also quickly, so that, you know, we save time. Can I make it here? In this, yeah, let me make it. So let's say not P, not Q, just to save time, because I will be needing it. So this will be false, false, true, true. False, true, false, true. Yeah. So this becomes antecedent. This becomes consequent. Yeah. So husband didn't get a promotion, didn't take his wife. Good husband. Didn't get a promotion, took his wife. Very good husband. Got a promotion, didn't take his wife. Bad husband. Got a promotion, took his wife. Good husband. Okay. Now here you will realize one thing, that these two truth tables are matching. Do you realize that? Right? So number two conclusion, write down everybody. Number two conclusion. Converse is logically equivalent to the inverse. Okay. Converse is logically equivalent to the inverse. Correct? Please note it down. Very important. Now coming to the last one. This becomes your antecedent. This becomes your consequent. So didn't get a promotion, didn't take his wife, good husband. Got a promotion, didn't take his wife, bad husband. Didn't get a promotion, took his wife, good husband. Got a promotion, took his wife, good husband. Okay, now here what do you see? These two are matching. Do you see that? The yellows are matching, isn't it? So what is conclusion number three? Conclusion number three is P implies Q is equivalent to saying not Q implies not P. Now here, something very important. See, both the things actually are same. There's no difference. It's just that you have flipped their names, isn't it? So if two is correct, then three will be definitely be correct. So this is not a surprise, because just you have changed the name from P to Q, Q to P. Correct. But what is important here to understand is that this is basically coming from the fact that Q is the necessary condition. So this is coming from, so this entire thing that you are getting, it's coming from the fact that Q is the necessary condition for P, which I already told you while I was explaining the topic to you. Correct. That means if Q doesn't happen, P will also not happen. See there. Getting my point. So when you say if P then Q, then it is like saying if Q doesn't happen, P will not happen. That means if the school is not closed, it will not be a Sunday. Getting my point. So that is the reason why I said Q was the necessary condition. Now see, truth table has justified it. Truth table has justified it that your consequent is a necessary condition for the antecedent. Got the point? So this is something which is very, very important. When we come back after the break, okay, we will do a few questions on this concept. And I'll also talk about if and only if. And then few minutes we'll spend on validation of statements. However, for JEE and other exams, validation is not important. But maybe for your school, they can ask you. So right now we'll go for a break. Our time now is 6:22. Let's meet exactly at 6:37 p.m. Okay, 15 minutes break. Eat something. Have something, some food, and we will meet after 15 minutes. Okay, enjoy your break. Many times students ask me this question. Can you write if P then Q in terms of your AND, NOT, or your OR operators that you have already used? Okay, so here is actually a question for all of you. Prove that if P then Q is logically equivalent to NOT P or Q, right? So you can generate, what I'm trying to claim here is that, or what I'm asking you to prove, that the truth table for this can also be obtained by doing this operation on these two statements. Okay. So if P then Q is logically equivalent to NOT P or Q, please prove this by using truth table. Everybody, please do this and tell me, are you able to prove this or not? I'm not solving it. I'm just making my tables so that I can use them. P, Q, not P. Okay. Make the truth table, everybody. I'm giving you 1 minute time. And let me know, are you able to prove it? Just say yes if you're able to prove it. No if you're not able to prove it. Done. Achintya, very good. So Achintya is the only person who got it, or anybody else got it? Satyam also got it. Well done. Neil, Omesh, Satyajit, Smriti, Venkat, Vishal, Yuvan, Harshada. Okay. Without much waste of time, let's do it. So this was our 4 entries for the 2 component statements. Negation of P will be false, false, true, true. This you already know from our previous exercise. Now, negation P or Q. So true or false or true, whatever you want to call it. That will be true only. False or false will be false. True or true will be true. False or true will be true. So what do you realize? You realize that it has the same truth table. Correct? Which means, yes, these two statements are logically equivalent. Okay. So your if P then Q can actually be written in terms of OR and negation operator like this. Okay. Now from here, very, very important takeaway is this, that if you want to negate, so important to note, that if you want to negate if P then Q, it is equivalent to saying negation of negation P. Correct? And as per your duality, or you can say as per your De Morgan's law, this will become negation of negation P, or will become AND negation of Q. So please note this down, everyone. Negation of P implies Q. negation of P implies Q is logically equivalent to saying P and not Q. Please note this down. Any questions? Any questions? Okay. All right. So let's take a few more questions where implications are involved. We will not take many questions, by the way. Okay, let's take this question. This could be a multiple option correct question. Okay, so please give me a response on the chat box. So the question says PQR are simple propositions. PQR are simple propositions with truth values of true, false, and true respectively. Okay, then what is the truth value of negation P or Q and negation R implies P? So this is a symbol for implies, the same symbol. So instead of putting a single arrow, they have put a double arrow, doesn't make a difference. So more than one option may be correct here. Maybe, I'm not guaranteeing that is all have to be correct, but may be correct. So give me all the responses that you feel are correct here on the chat box. Okay, Satyam. So you feel only one option is right? Okay. Well, the question is slightly written in a confusing way. In option C and D, they have changed R to false. So earlier in the initial question, they gave R as true. Then they change R to false. So let's say if it is true, false, false, then this statement will be true. That is what they're trying to say. And in option D, they have changed Q to true. So if it is true, 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 okay, then this statement is true. That is what they're trying to say. Oh, I guess that you would have, you know, misread or misinterpreted the question. So C and D question. Sorry, C and D option basically says that if you change only that R to false, then that statement will become true. Okay. And if you change your Q to true, then the statement will become true. That is what your C and D option say. Okay, so P, Q, R, negation P, negation R, we need negation P or Q, we need negation P or Q, and negation R, and then final statement, which is okay, Vishal. Yes, ready everybody? Okay, Satyam. Okay, so what initially they have given is that this is true, this is false, and this is true. Okay, so this becomes false. Correct? This also becomes false. Okay. Now, negation P or Q. So false or false will be false. Okay. False and anything will be false by default. Okay. Now think this is your antecedent and this is your consequent. So husband not getting promotion, taking the wife to Singapore. Good husband. So true. So as per this, as per the initial condition given to us of true, false, true, this is true. So option A is for sure correct. Okay. Next in option C, so B cannot be correct. Vishal, sorry, B is wrong. In option C, they have said, make R as false. So let this be true, this will be false, and make R also as false. So let's see what happens. So this becomes true. Okay, this becomes again a true. Okay, negation P or Q. Negation P or Q will become a true. Okay, and negation P or Q and with negation R, that will also become true if I'm not mistaken. Correct, because negation R is also true. So these two and will also be true. Okay, now husband getting a promotion, taking his wife to Singapore. Yes, he's a good husband. So this will be true. So option C is also correct. Is it fine? Any questions related to option C being correct? Okay. Now let's take option number D. D says make Q as true. Then see what happens. Okay, let's see. So P is true, Q also make it true, and R they have given already in the initial part as true. Okay. So R will be by default taken as true. So this will become false. This will become false. Now negation P or Q. Negation P or Q will become false. Negation P or Q will become false. False and anything will be false. Okay. Now, husband getting not getting a promotion, still taking his wife to Singapore trip. He's a good husband, very good husband. So T will be true, will be correct for D as well. So A, C, D. A, C, D is going to be right. Yes, Satyam, any issues? Do let me know. Didn't get house C. P is F. No, P is true. There's, as per the question, P is always true. Why should I put F for that? Oh, sorry. Negation of P is F here. Okay. So F or Q. Okay. F or Q, this will be F. Oh, sorry. F or Q will be F here. F or Q will be F here. Okay. And F intersection, this will be F. Correct? Correct, but thankfully this doesn't change my answer. Satyam, clear? Thanks for highlighting that out, but thankfully it did not change my answer. Thankfully. Achintya, what was your question? Are you now clear how did I get C option correct? That's what you are doing right now. Got it? Okay. Now coming to the second implication, which is your if and only if implication. So B is if and only if. So if you have a statement like if and only if P, then Q, it is basically read as P is the sufficient and necessary condition. Of Q and vice versa. Q is the sufficient and necessary condition for P. I think I should use for here. Okay. That means both implies the other. That is why we use the symbol with a double arrow like this. Okay. Now, logically speaking, if somebody says, if and only if P then Q, then these two statements actually become equivalent. That means if somebody says P, automatically Q will imply. If somebody says Q, automatically P will imply. So they will become like the Jai Veeru of Sholay movie. Okay. So if P is happening, Q will happen. And if P is not happening, Q will also not happen. Are you getting my point? So one will imply the other. So we say normally that this is logically equivalent to saying P implies Q and Q implies P. Okay. So when somebody says if and only if P then Q, he indirectly means P implies Q and Q implies P. That means P implies and is implied by Q. Okay. Now let me explain this to a simple example. So if I give this statement, if and only if it is a Sunday, then the school is closed. Okay, then the school is closed. So if this statement is correct, or if this statement is true, then it means that if somebody comes and tells me, hey, it's a Sunday, then it automatically implies the school is closed. And if somebody comes and says, hey, if it is not a Sunday, then it automatically implies that the school is open. Are you getting my point? And vice versa also. So if somebody comes and tells me, hey, the school is closed, that means automatically it is a Sunday. Or if somebody comes and tells me, hey, the school is not closed, then it is automatically not a Sunday. So they will both occur together or they will not both occur. And they will both not occur together. So they are very close friends, right? So P and Q will together be true or together will be false. Then only this statement will be true. Or if this statement is true, both have to be true or both have to be false. Are you getting my point, what I'm trying to say? Right? So one implies the other. That is what we need to understand here. So any one statement of the two, if I say, other will automatically be applicable. Right? So in light of this, the truth table that we normally make for if and only if P, then Q is something like this. Please note this down. True will be only happening in these two cases when both are true or both are false. Okay. If any one of them is true and other is false, it will become false. Correct. That means, let's say, I'll justify this truth table. If I give you this statement that, hey, if and only if it is a Sunday, then the school is closed. Correct. Now, let us say it was a Sunday, right? You went to school. Your school was closed. Will you call me up and say you were true or will you call me up and say you were false? You will definitely say you are true, sir. Right? Aap jo bola, sahi bola. Correct. But if you go to the school on a Sunday and you realize the school is working, then obviously my statement becomes false. Right, sir, you told if and only if it is a Sunday, the school is closed. I went on a Sunday, school is functioning. So you are false. Correct. And if you didn't go on a Sunday, let's say you went on a Monday and the school is closed, then also my statement will be false because I said the school will be closed if and only if it is a Sunday. So how come the school is closed when it is a non-Sunday? correct? Then also my statement will become a false. But if you don't go on a Sunday and the school is open, then my statement still is valid, because I said if and only if it is a Sunday, then the school will be closed. Did you go on a Sunday? No. Is the school working? Is the school working? Yes. So if it is, if you're not going on a Sunday and the school is working, that is none of my problem, because I said if and only if it is a Sunday, then the school will be closed. Are you getting my point? So my statement still holds valid. So please understand here in the truth table, only when both are true, it will be true. Or only when both are false, it will be true. Rest in all the cases, it will be false, false. So as a homework, please verify this by using truth table. Okay, you already know your truth tables for implications. Sorry, conditional implications, if then implications. So verify it by truth table in your as your homework. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Now, once we have learned this, the negation is also very simple to write down. So negation of, please note this down, negation of, if and only if P then Q is equivalent to the negation of this guy. P implies Q and Q implies P, correct? Which is equivalent to, I hope I have space here. Yeah. Which is equivalent to saying negation of this or negation of this. Okay. Which is equivalent to saying, no, now the negation of this we have already seen in the previous slide, P and not Q. Or negation of this will be Q and not P. Is it fine? Sorry, I should say note it down. Oh, I've already written it. So please make a note of this, very, very important. Clear? Any questions? All right. Let's take a small question. Okay. This question came in Manipal exam. Okay. Manipal takes its own entrance exam. If P and Q are two statements, then negation of P and Q, or negation of if and only if Q then P, okay, is a tautology, contradiction, neither tautology nor contradiction, either tautology or contradiction. Let's do this question. I'm launching the poll for all of you. Please, whenever such question comes, make good use of the truth table. Make good use of the truth table. The person who has answered with D is definitely not going to be the answer. So I would request people who are answering now onwards, either tautology or a contradiction. It cannot be both. So it's a statement. So you're stating the statement is always false, or it could always be true. Right? It cannot happen like that. It has to be one of them. If at all it is one of them. So So D is pakka wrong. So either it is tautology, or it is a contradiction, or it is a contingency. So these are three, you know, disjoint sets. It will fall in either one of the category. Okay, Satyam. Okay, I can give you 30 more seconds. So please complete this. Truth table doesn't take much time. I think one and a half minutes is good enough to make a table with two component statements. So only two component statements I can see in this question, P and Q. Should not take much time. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, end of poll. Out of 7 people who have responded, 4 of you have said option number C. All right, so let us make a truth table for the same. So here the truth table required is of P, Q, P and Q, negation of P and Q. If and only if Q then P, negation of that and the final WFF. Okay, so this is P, this is Q, this is P and Q, this is negation of P and Q, this is Q, okay. If and only if Q, then P, then negation of that guy also. And then final, let me make it properly. Yeah, and then final statement, which is this. Okay, very straightforward. This is not a rocket science. Okay, I hope everybody is finding it comfortable to understand. So true, 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 false, false, true, false, false. P and Q will be true, false, false, false. Negation will be false, true, true, true. Now, if and only if Q, then P. Only when both are true, it will be true. Or only when both of them are false, it will be false. So it will be like this. Okay. Negation of this will be false, true, true, false. Now, this and this, you have to take the OR. So false or false will be false. The moment you get a true here, stop. In fact, let me complete it. So it is neither tautology nor a contradiction. So it is actually falling in option number C. It's a contingency. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Any questions, any concerns? All right. So we are now going on to the last part of the chapter, which is basically nothing but validation of implications. Validation of implications. So if you have been given an implication, how do you validate it? That is what we are going to talk about it. Okay, just give me a second. Yeah, sorry, somebody was at the door. Yeah. Now, a validation of implication. How do you validate an implication? So basically, if I give you a statement, if P, then Q. Okay. How do you validate this statement? So to validate this statement, there are three ways to do it. Or there are three, you can say, methods that we normally follow. One method is called the direct method. Okay. So we'll discuss this method. The second method is called the contrapositive method. And the third method is known as the contradiction method. Okay. Now, how do these methods work? Let me explain this one by one to you. In fact, I will take an example also to support it. So the first method, direct method, how do we prove that a given implication, if P then Q is true by direct method, we follow the following three steps. Step number A, we assume that P is true. Okay, so what do? We assume that this antecedent P, this is true. And using this assumption, that means using A, we prove that Q is true. That means if both P and Q are true, we know from our truth table that P implies Q will also become true. Remember the truth table? Husband getting promotion and taking his wife, good husband, so true, correct? So how does this method work? With an example, let me explain you. So if these two are done, that means this implies that this is going to be true. Let's take a small question and I will explain it via that question. So how does direct method help you to prove this? So let's say I want to prove this statement. So there's a statement P, which says that if X is real number such that X cube plus 4X is zero, then X is equal to zero. Okay. We need to validate the statement. We need to validate means we need to prove that the statement is true by using direct method. So I'll be only talking about direct method because I have not done contradiction method and contrapositive method yet. So this is how we approach. So first of all, I would break P as something like R implying Q. Okay. Or R implying S. Let's take S. So please note that the name has got changed. Okay. They have started calling. Okay. You do one thing. You start calling this as R itself so that, you know, we continue using our old name, P and Q. So just so that you can match whatever I have written in the theory part with this. Okay. So let's say this is your statement R and you want to validate this R statement. So what we have done, we have written it as a P implies Q statement where P says X is real and X cube plus 4X is zero. Okay. And Q says X is equal to zero. So you want to prove this statement by using direct method. So what do? We first say let P be true. Okay. That means we are assuming that X cube plus 4X is equal to zero and X is a real number. Now this will imply that this will be true, correct? And this can mean only two things. Either X could be zero or X square plus 4 could be zero. But this is not possible. Why this is not possible? Because X is a real number. Right, you can't have a real number square plus 4 equal to 0. So this finally implies that X is 0, right? So if X is 0 means you have proven that Q is true. Correct? So what did the direct method say? Assuming P is true, if you prove that Q is true, then if P, then Q will become true. That means our statement that was given to us is actually a true statement. Is it fine? Any questions? Is it fine? Any question related to how does a direct method work? Clear? Now, these parts will not be tested in your competitive exam. So this is only for your school exam, I'm telling you, if at all they come in school exam. But many a times in class 11th, the teacher is the decision maker. If she feels this part is not going to be useful in 12th, she might not even cover it. It is up to her. Okay. So when you do that chapter in school, you would realize that it is actually required for you or not. But of course, it is not there for competitive exam. Okay, competitive exam is not going to ask you to prove something. The second method is the contrapositive method. The contrapositive method basically works on this principle that this statement is logically equivalent to this statement. Correct? We already know that if P then Q basically is equivalent to saying if not Q then not P, because Q is the necessary condition for P. Isn't it? So what do we do in this method? We apply a direct method on this guy. That means we assume that negation Q is true. Correct? That means you are assuming that Q is false. Okay? And then by using this assumption, right, we prove that negation P is true. That means you indirectly prove that your Q is false. Sorry, P is false. So what are you doing? You are actually applying a direct method to this guy. So indirect method, what did we do? Antecedent, we used to assume it is true. And then the consequent, we used to prove that it is going to be true because of that assumption. That is what we did in the previous slide. So here your antecedent is negation Q. So you're assuming that your negation Q is true. And using that negation, you are trying to prove that negation P is true. So when you do that, then by direct method, basically this will become true. Correct? And since these two are logically equivalent, this will also become true. Right? So you are coming from your contrapositive direction to prove the validity of the statement. And that is why the name of this method is called the contrapositive method. Okay, let me demonstrate this. Let me demonstrate it in the same example which I took a little while ago. But make a note of this first of all. Done, copied. Okay, let's take the same example. So the same question now I'm going to solve by using the contrapositive method, which is your third method over here. I'll come to contradiction after this. Okay. So here I will start with, again, let me name this guy to be R first of all. So let's call it as R. Okay. Let's call this part as your P. And let's call this part as your Q. Okay. So here we'll start with the fact that let Q be false. That means I'm doing step number one. See here, step number one, negation Q is true means Q is false. That means you're trying to first start with let X be not equal to zero. Correct? Now we already know that X square plus 4 is going to be a positive quantity if your X is real. Correct? So if you multiply this with the first one, so let's say I call this as second one, this I call it as the first one, second one. Now, if I multiply one with two, so basically you're trying to say that this term will be not equal to zero because anyways, this is positive and this is not equal to zero. And if you're multiplying a not equal to zero with positive, it will definitely be not equal to zero. Correct. In other words, you're trying to say x cube plus 4x is not equal to 0. What does it mean? You're trying to say that P is false. Correct. So basically, what did you achieve here? You first of all started with the assumption that negation Q is true, and you ended up proving that negation P is true. So in light of the direct method, you have actually proven that this is true. And by the fact that this statement is the logical equivalence of this, you have actually proved that this is true. Done. Is it clear? So this whole thing is basically based out on the fact that Q is the necessary condition for P. So you first prove that the contrapositive of that statement is true somehow by the use of direct method. And because the contrapositive is true, the contrapositive is the logical equivalence of if P then Q. So both will become true then. Is it clear? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? Okay, coming to the third method. So we have already done direct method, contrapositive method. Now the third method is called the contradiction method. See, contradiction method is not a new method for you all. Maybe you did not know the name for it, but you were already using it in class 10th. I'm sure most of you would remember this question. Prove that root 2 is a irrational number. Did you solve these kind of questions in class 10th? I'm sure in abundance, you would have solved it. Kilo ke bhav se. In abundance. Root 2, root 5, root 3, any type of thing, root 7, anything could be made as a question. Yes, correct. So actually, you used contradiction method there. So you started with something which is like contradictory to what you are supposed to prove, isn't it? So let's say you are asked to prove that root 2 is a irrational number. So you started with let root 2 be a rational number. And then you did something, and you result. And at a step, you came into a contradiction. So you came to a fact that which is not possible. It is contradiction. Contradiction is not possible. And then what you did, you basically changed your assumption itself by the law of excluded middle. So if your root 2 is not a rational number, it has to be irrational. That is how you used to prove it. So more or less, the similar approach will be utilized here also. So what do we do here? We basically follow the truth table where it said that if husband got a promotion and wife was not taken to Singapore, or he did not take his wife to Singapore, he is not a good husband. So the only situation, so basically this method is based out of this truth table. So the fact that antecedent is true and consequent is false, that only makes your if then statement false. That is going to be used over here. So what I'm going to do here is, if I want to prove that this is true, what I will do, I will do this. I will say, let P be true, or I will assume P to be true and Q to be false. Indirectly, what am I doing? So instead of proving true, I'm assuming that, okay, let P be true and Q be false means I'm assuming that this is false, isn't it? So this is indirectly what I'm assuming. Am I right? See, what I have to prove? I have to prove root 2 is rational. Irrational. So I'm assuming that let root 2 be irrational. Oh, sorry, what I'm saying. If I have to prove that root 2 is irrational, I'm assuming that let root 2 be rational. Okay, so ulta I'm assuming. The opposite I'm assuming. So for assuming that this is false, I have to assume that P is 2 and Q is false. And with this assumption, you actually reach or you end up or you reach a contradiction. Reach a contradiction means you reach a step where you realize that you know, that is not possible. That is always a contradiction. It cannot happen. Okay. So in this case, what do? You change this assumption. So this assumption becomes wrong. The assumption that, so this implies that the assumption of P implies Q is false is itself false. Okay. So your assumption that it was false becomes false. So by involution law, what does it mean? This is true. So this is another way of proving it. Okay. Let me demonstrate it. Then you'll understand what do I mean to say. First, note this step down. Then I will demonstrate these steps in the very same example. Tomorrow again 4 to 7:30 we'll have a class on parabola. It's not going to be a lengthy session. One class is good enough to complete parabola as well. Okay, so tomorrow's class will be end of parabola. And one more thing is then next week we will still have two classes, Friday, Saturday, but post that week we will only have one classes as usual, and that too on Tuesday. So we'll go back to the Tuesday schedule. Okay, so next week we will have Friday, Saturday once again, and next to next week we will have only on Tuesdays. So you'll get back to your Tuesdays classes. Okay, anyways, let's solve this question. So I'll be now solving this question by method of contradiction. So again, let me call this as R. Okay, and let me call this as P. And let me call this as Q. Okay. So in contradiction method, what do we say? We say let P be true and Q be false. So basically you have used the and connector here. So what you're doing, you're assuming P be true and Q be false. That means you're saying XQ plus 4X is equal to 0. Okay. And at the same time, you're saying X is not equal to 0. Okay. That means you're saying X into X square plus 4 is 0. And at the same time, you're saying X is not equal to 0. Correct? That means you're trying to say X is equal to 0 because your X square plus 4 cannot be 0. Okay. So if X is a real number, if X is a real number, then X square plus 4 cannot be 0, right? So this automatically implies that only X could be 0. So now you're writing something like this. You're saying X is 0 and X is not 0 also. Isn't this a clear-cut contradiction? You're saying Q and not Q. Q and not Q is a contradiction, isn't it? They cannot happen together. Okay, this is clearly a contradiction step. Correct? So that means this assumption, let's say I call this assumption as assumption A. Okay, this assumption will become a wrong assumption. Right? So this clearly states that your assumption A is false. Right? That means you trying to claim that P is true and Q is false itself is false, right? That means you trying to claim that this is false. So what does this mean? This means it is false, right? So assumption A is trying to say that this is false. So if assumption A itself is false, means this is true. Simple as that. So this is how you prove it, by contradiction. So thanks to the fact that a statement cannot be true and false simultaneously. That's the whole beginning point of our, you know, discussion. Remember, I started my discussion by saying that a statement cannot be true and false together. So that thing is actually saving me here. Because if a statement could be true and false together, then I could not use this method of contradiction to solve it. Okay. So this is how we validate it. Now, when it comes to if and only if. For if and only if, I don't have to give you a separate gyan, because if and only if is, okay, so let's talk about validation of if and only if. See, if and only if is basically made up of this and this, correct? Now, if you want to validate it, use any of the methods to show that both have to be true. Because if any one of them become false, you know that a conjunction will become a false, isn't it? Right? So in order to prove that this is true, you have to show that this is also true and this is also true. And for this, you can use any of the three methods that you feel like. Okay? You could use method of, like you use direct method. Okay, or you could use contradiction method, or you could use contrapositive method. Okay, any of the three methods could be used here. Okay, so for proving this, you can use, for these two, you can use this. So basically, you have to validate these two separately by any of the three methods. So this is not, you know, completely different from what we already did. It is just doing it twice. Okay. So you have to prove P implies Q is true. You can use any of the three methods. And you have to also prove that Q implies P is true. You can use any of the three methods. Okay. So once both are true, then only you can say if and only if P then Q is a true statement. Okay. So there's no point taking any question here because it is just the same thing, doing same type of methods used twice. Okay, so this is how, you know, you will be asked questions if at all you are asked these kind of questions in your school exam. So we cover up this topic as well. I will be sending you one worksheet based on the same. Okay, thanks a lot. Tomorrow, see you again. I will send you the reminder right now. So see you tomorrow with parabola session. Yes, this chapter is over. Okay, there's nothing in this chapter other than these type of compound statements. Okay, so you can solve all the JEE problems based on whatever we have done. All right, bye. Take care, everybody.